I cut the check, I cut the check, I cut the check. Tell my niggas we up next, so we up next. She shot a text, she shot a text, she shot a text. Kill the p***, I might put the bitch to rest. Put a nigga on that same shit. I've been ballin' with my niggas, Kevin Cambridge. Oh, you drippy, but you better tuck your chain quick.
What's good, y'all? Screaming for my voice. Yeah, what's good, y'all? We back with another episode. We got a lot of things to talk about. The Super Bowl just happened. We got a new NFL champion. And I'm also going to announce my Western Conference All-Stars as I did my Eastern Conference All-Stars last week. So let's get straight into it. Tampa Bay won the Super Bowl. And what happened, what I said was going to happen, or what I hoped to happen, actually happened. I said this last week, and if you remember, if you don't remember, go check the episode out. I said, this Buccaneers defense has been playing lights out. And with the talent and the names that they have, this is the perfect defense to stop this juggernaut offense that the Chiefs have. The linebackers that they have, like I said, Lavonte David, Devin White, they're some of the fastest linebackers I've ever seen. Some of the greatest cover linebackers I've ever seen. Lavonte David was really had Travis Kelce unlocked the whole game into the fourth quarter. That's when Travis Kelce kind of broke loose. But when the fourth quarter happened, that game was already over. That game was basically over at halftime. But that defense is playing lights out yesterday. A lot of double teams on Tyreek Hill. Because if you don't remember, when they played him, I want to say week 12, Tyreek Hill had like 200 yards in one quarter. And that's amazing. People don't even get that in one game. He had that in one quarter. And basically, they just held him to like 40 yards yesterday. He was getting double teamed the whole game. He couldn't do nothing. And then, like I said, Lavonte David and what's the other dude's name? Devin White, they just had Travis Kelce on lock. And then the pressure, Patrick Mahomes could not throw the ball yesterday. He couldn't. And I'm not going to put that all on that offensive line, because sometimes Patrick Mahomes, he just didn't seem like he was in the game at all. But like, he was running the whole game. Jason Pierre-Paul, Shaquille Barrett, like I said, I even forgot they had Ndamukong Suh. They were back there the whole game. But let's get into it. We started off a couple 3-and-outs from both teams. Then Tampa Bay scored, and I'm not going to lie, Tom Brady looked really good yesterday. I'm talking about accuracy on accuracy. And if you don't remember what he did the game before that against the Packers, he had a decent game, started off really good. But then threw three interceptions, and I was like, all right, he looks really good today, but I'm not going to overreact because we did just see what he did last week. But, nah, it was two different Tom Brady's. Tom Brady didn't do nothing bad yesterday, had no terrible throws, except one. It was a slant route. He didn't really know who he was throwing it to. But, like I said, Tom Brady had an amazing game yesterday, and I kind of was like, yo, the Chiefs been down a lot, and they always come back on like a 30-0 run, but like, like I said, it was something different about this game. And maybe it was because a lot of the penalties that the Chiefs were getting, some of them were uncalled for. I'll give the Chiefs that. A lot of people said they cheated for Tom Brady. It was like two or three calls that I'm like, all right, you didn't have to call that. But I want to say they cheated for Tom Brady. I feel like a lot of them calls is obvious. Like one call that really jumped out to a lot of people was that call on the pass interference when it was like 40 seconds left in the half and Mike Evans got tripped. You can't touch the dude when the ball's not even near him yet. He tripped him. That's a pass interference. They call that anytime. So that was the call that was really controversial yesterday. But that was a good call to me. There's some other questionable calls here and there, but other than that, it wasn't no real call that really cost them the game. Like, they were costing themselves a game. It was a lot of pass interference, a lot of holding, and then you got Chris Jones smacking the center, and that was like a 15-yard penalty. That's on them. I wouldn't blame that on the refs. They just they playing football at the end of the day, but you still can control your own destiny. You shouldn't be smacking nobody. I don't know why he was so mad after the game, talking about we didn't have no penalties. But like, dude, a lot of them penalties was y'all fault. Y'all were holding. You, like I said, you smacking somebody is just uncalled for. Now, it did seem like they were going after Tyrann Mathieu a lot, though. Like, Tyrann Mathieu ran up and said something to Tom Brady. Tom Brady threw the touchdown on the next play, and then Tom Brady chased Tyrann Mathieu and was talking smack to him. And then they called the, what is that called? Unnecessary roughness or something like that. Not unnecessary roughness. I don't know, showboating or something. They called that on Tyrann Mathieu. And I'm like, why would you call that on him when he was just walking off the field and Tom Brady came up to him? I was like, all right, that was a really questionable call because he didn't do nothing. They talk smack. One, that's a soft call in any sport. You talk a smack and you get a penalty, that's a soft call. But they talk a smack and Tom Brady runs up to him and talks more smack and you call down on the person that's just walking away. That's a questionable call. But other than that, it really was no questionable calls. Couple things that jumped out to me this game was my boy AB, he got a ring and he got a touchdown in the Super Bowl. I'm really happy for Antonio Brown because he's a person that was getting down in the media last year. People were saying he's not a good person at all. They said he's crazy. And he was acting like it. I give him that. He was acting like it. But the fact that he just wanted to play with Tom Brady and he got a ring with Tom Brady, I'm so happy for him. Happy for Leonard Fournette. As soon as he got dropped by the Jaguars, I already knew he was going to get picked up by the Bucs. So, and he showed up yesterday. He had a lot of strong runs. And I was like, all right, that's LSU Leonard Fournette. He ran two people over back-to-back plays. Gronk had two touchdowns in the first half. He looked amazing yesterday. I'm not gonna lie, fast, big, route running, blocking. He looked amazing. But I'm not gonna lie. I know Tom Brady is Tom Brady, and I knew they weren't gonna give it to the MVP who really deserved the MVP. I think one of them linebackers deserved the MVP. Them boys, they are so fast. It was one play. Devin White outran the blocker. He knew where the blocker was gonna be at. Outran the blocker and made the wide open tackle on what's his name, Clyde Edwards. I don't know how you say his last name, but he made a wide open tackle on him, and I'm like, yo, how did he get there so fast? Like, often, as soon as he says that, he's already downhill. And it's Shaquille Barrett, the way he be jumping the ball sometimes, that should be wild sometimes. Then you got Jason Pierre-Paul on the other side of the field. Like, there's really no way you can really block against that defensive line, especially when you don't even have your starting tackles. That's one thing that was kind of sad to see, that the Chiefs didn't have their starting tackles for the big game, and it hurt them in the long run. Like I said, Patrick Mahomes ran 500 yards trying to get away from the rush the whole game. And it was crazy, bro. He could not sit back there and just dart the defense up because he's running the whole time. And then some throws that, like, he was falling, and the throws are still accurate. And I was like, yo, this man is amazing. Like, he was falling parallel to the ground, threw a sidearm throw, and the dude just dropped it. But the fact that it got to him and it was like 30 yards away, I'm like, yo, how did he even almost complete that? And then you got to think about it. He has a turf toe injury. That's a really bad injury. And he's limping the whole game from start to finish, limping the whole game. So the fact that some of the stuff that he was doing that didn't get completed, kudos to him. Like I said, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers did what they were supposed to do. It sucks they didn't have that lineman, but next man up mentality all the time, and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers just dominated them. I didn't see no cheating calls. I don't understand why people want to say that. But yeah, they held them to no touchdowns, straight field goals from the Chiefs. It was a fun game to watch, even though it was a blowout. Like, I don't really find blowouts fun to watch, but it was a fun game to watch because the defense was just so energetic. The one thing that jumped out to me too is they had a Super Bowl in their home field. That's kind of crazy. That's kind of weird. I'm not going to lie. That's weird. That's weird. If y'all want to talk about Tom Brady getting cheated, people cheating for Tom Brady, that's weird. I'm not saying that this Super Bowl is supposed to be in Tampa for the longest time. But, like, the fact that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers made it to the Super Bowl is crazy. And they were the first team to ever have a Super Bowl in their home field. So, that's cool for them. But, yeah, other than that, it was a really good game to me, though. Really good game. I know the Chiefs going to bounce back. They just need to get some stuff figured out on the defensive side. Like, I don't know. Their cornerbacks are not that good. Tyrann Mathieu, he's cool, but he's not all that to me. But, yeah, they'll get it figured out, though. The offense will carry him. But it was a really good game. But, like I said, I wanted to jump into my Western Conference All-Stars. They just said it that they're actually going to have an All-Star game, and a lot of the NBA players were kind of mad, like Giannis, LeBron, Kawhi, De'Aaron Fox. They all said it was stupid, and they all had, like, the same message. It's all for money, basically, and that's something we all knew. It's basically all for money, and it's kind of like a slap in the face because, like, we out here playing for y'all. And we're playing for ourselves, too, but we're out here playing, making y'all money, and instead of giving us, like, a two-week break where we can chill with our families, probably go on a little vacation, we're still with COVID guidelines with our families. Y'all want to make us go to Atlanta, probably the worst place with COVID, because they don't have no rules down there. All the clubs are open. You see videos of people in clubs every day. You want us to go to Atlanta and play in the All-Star game for what? for no reason. Instead of just giving us 2 weeks off like it was supposed to get. I don't understand it, but it's going to happen. So the captain of the team, I wanted to put Jokic because I felt like Jokic has been the best player in the West this season. But, you know, LeBron's going to get it. He's definitely going to get it. So LeBron's been having a great season, been averaging 25 points, 7 assists, 7 rebounds, 49 from the field, and 41 from the three. That's crazy for LeBron that he's getting better at three-point shot. And team's 18-6. And he's had a lot of clutch moments. A lot of people have been saying LeBron's never been clutch. This season he's had a lot of clutch moments. And I give it to him. He just had one clutch moment against the Detroit Pistons. And I don't know what's up with the Pistons. Like, they show up against teams that's, like, the best in the league. Like, all their wins are against teams that's the best in the league. And that's crazy. But, yeah, they had a double overtime with the Pistons. And then the last overtime, LeBron hit back-to-back step-back threes. And I'm like, yeah, that's a clutch moment. And he's had a lot of clutch moments this season. Defense doesn't really look up to par as it did last season. But you got to think about it. These dudes were just in the finals a couple months ago. So, like, AD's not a starter. And AD was damn near not even an all-star to me because he's had an on-and-off season. He hasn't really looked in there, like... I haven't really seen AD dominate like he was dominating all last season, pre-bubble and in the bubble. But, yeah, LeBron's the captain. The first guard is Steph Curry. Can't be nobody Steph Curry. Averaging 29 points, 5 rebounds, 6 assists, 48 from the field, 42 from the three. Team's 12-11. And I know the crazy thing about Steph Curry is, like, when this season started, they got blown out by the Bucks. They got blown out by the Nets. And everybody was like, yes. All the Steph Curry haters were like, yes, Steph Curry's finally getting exposed, which I don't understand people like that. I don't understand why people feed off of people's defeats. I don't understand that. But everybody was like, yes, he's going to get exposed. They're not going to make the playoffs. They were happy to see him lose, basically, because for the past few years, Steph Curry has been dominating. And they were happy to see him lose. But now the team's in the eighth seed of the playoffs right now, and they're done. From like 2-3, I mean from like 4-12 as far as seeds, they're all separated by at least one game. Like, nobody really has a lead but the Clippers, the Jazz, surprisingly, and the Lakers. But Steph Curry's had a really good season. Just had a 50-point game, I want to say, on Thursday. And just had... No, on Saturday. And he had a great game on Thursday, too. Had a 60-point game earlier in the season, shooting lights out. And that team's not bad. And the team's actually really fun to watch when they're clicking. When they're not clicking, they're terrible to watch. But, yeah, he's doing a really good job with this team. It's going to be some struggles. You really don't have your road dog in Klay Thompson. And you really got a lot of players trying to learn how to play in the Warriors system. But they're getting it together, man. Steph Curry's doing his thing. Shooting the best I ever seen him shoot. Like, he's averaging better numbers than he did when he was an MVP in 2016. And that's crazy. But, great season from him. My next guard, Damian Lillard. Who's also having a great season, but it's under the radar. And I feel like it's under the radar because coming into the season with the all-season additions that the Portland Trailblazers added, me and a lot of people were thinking, like, yo, this team is legit. Like, this team is a title contender. But they haven't really been good. Like, CJ McCollum's, and some of it's not their fault. Injuries, they always deal with them. But CJ McCollum's been out for a couple weeks, and he's probably going to be out for a couple more. I think he's going to be out for at least 2 more months. And he was having an all-star season, but even when he was playing, they weren't that good. What's his name? Yusuf Nurkic, he's out for a couple months. And then the all-season additions that they added, like Robert Covington, he's playing terrible. Derrick Jones Jr. is he's on and off. He hasn't been that good. And this Cantor has been decent. But, like, I don't know, this team's just been flying under the radar. They've been looking really bad sometimes, and sometimes they look really good. But they're still having a good season, 29 points, 4 rebounds, 7 assists, 45 from the field, 38 from the three. Team's 12-10. Like I said, all the teams from like the 4th team to like the 12th team, they're all separated by at least one game. But Dame's having a really good season. Definitely an all-star starter. I couldn't put Luka over him because Luka's been having a bad season. He's been having a bad season. I'm not going to put that all on him, but like the shooting. Like, shooting 28% from the three, that's terrible. Luka, you gotta get that out. But, yep, Dame's having a good season. My next forward slash center is Kawhi. Kawhi, it was between Kawhi and PG. Oh my god. I just noticed something. I forgot to put PG in this. I gotta take somebody out. But yeah, PG. I mean Kawhi, I'm sorry. My, this COVID stuff, crazy. But Kawhi averaging 26 points, 5 rebounds, 5 assists, 50 from the field, 37 from the 3, and the team 17-6. They're having a really good season as far as a bounce back season. And it's really good for them that they're flying under the radar, because if you looked at it last season, everybody was thinking about, oh, Lakers versus Clippers. They was thinking about that the whole season. And then the Clippers kind of fumbled the ball and didn't even make it to face the Lakers. So the fact that they're under the radar this season, they humbled themselves. PG's playing like an MVP again. I still feel like they're one piece away to actually challenge the Lakers. But they look really good this season. Kawhi's been having a lot of good games lately. He started off kind of slow and PG was kind of taking control in the beginning of the season. But Kawhi is definitely doing good now. They just lost to the Kings, who were having a really good season. And now the thing about it, it's a lot of Western Conference All-Stars that I can really put on this list. And it's hard. That some people are definitely missing. But yeah, Kawhi's having a really good season. But next is Jokic. Jokic is dominating this season. Just had a 50 ball the other day. 27 points, 11 rebounds, 8 assists. From the center, 8 assists, 56 from the field, 39 from the 3, almost 40% from the 3 as a center. Team's 12-10, and the reason why they're 12-10 is not his fault. The surrounding pieces that shine in the bubble are not really shining. MPJ is having a decent season, even though he just came back from missing like a month for COVID. Jamal Murray, the player that a lot of people would expect to take that next jump, not really taking that next jump. And I don't know, this team doesn't, they just doesn't look, they don't look the same. And if Jokic doesn't have a good game, they're not going to do nothing. But he's been having an awesome season. I think he played Rudy Gobert. He had like 40 points in 3 quarters. And just had a 50 ball. He's dominating this season. And I don't know. The center's running the league this year. Rudy Gobert is having a really good season. Joel Embiid's having a really good season. Jokic. Center's doing really good this season. But yeah, that wraps up the starting lineup. First guard off the bench, like I said, Luka. 27 points, 9 rebounds, 8 assists, and teams 10-14. But I don't know, this team's kind of, they're not doing as good as I expected them to do or as I wanted them to do. And a major part is because of him. He hasn't been having those games that jump off the chart like he had last year. He's getting his triple doubles. I would say the first really, really good game that he had this season was against the Warriors on Saturday when he had 40 points. And he kind of dominated in that fourth quarter. And he had hit some clutch shots. But other than that, he hasn't really had a good season. So I can't really put him over Steph, over Dame. But he still had an all-star type season. This is hard. I'm going to put PG right here. I don't know his numbers because I forgot. To be honest, I forgot. But PG's definitely an all-star. I know he's averaging 26+. He's averaging like 5 assists. And I the team is 17-6. And he's had a lot of really good games, and he's definitely an all-star. And the third guard is between Donovan Mitchell, DeMar DeRozan, and De'Aaron Fox. I want to give it to De'Aaron Fox, but I want to give it to DeMar because I feel like his season, he's been flying under the radar. 20 points, 5 rebounds, 6 assists, a really good playmaker. And I loved how he changed his game to being a decent playmaker. And the team's 13-10. The team's overachieving. Like every year for the past 3 years, a lot of people are like, yeah, this is the year when the Spurs is going to fall off, and they just keep doing good. But yeah, they're 13-10. DeMar's having a really underrated season, but I don't know if I can give him that all-star leap over Donovan Mitchell and De'Aaron Fox. And between Donovan Mitchell and De'Aaron Fox, I don't know, man. Here's the cases. Donovan Mitchell's having a really good season. 23 points, 4 rebounds, 4 assists. The team's 19-5. They went on like a 10-game winning streak. And I feel like this team deserves 2 All-Stars. And he's been a major part of them doing this good. But the De'Aaron Fox team just won 7 out of the last 10 games. And he's been averaging 30 points over these last 10 games. He's been averaging like 30 points and like 7 assists. And he has a lot of clutch moments. Like against the Celtics, he took over in that fourth quarter. And against the Clippers, he took over in the last 2 minutes of that game. So, I don't know. I'm going to just say both of them are all-stars, but I don't know who I'm going to pick. I don't know who I will pick, and I'm not going to pick. But, yeah, they're both should be in an all-star contention. And the four forwards that are coming off this bench are Zion, B.I., Anthony Davis, and C. Christian Wood. And now that I say that, I feel like Rudy Gobert deserves to be an all-star. So out of those four people I just named, Zion, B.I., A.D., Christian Wood, I know A.D.'s going to make it, even though I feel like out of those four, he's having the worst season. So it's between B.I. and Rudy Gobert. And I don't know, like I said, I feel like the Jazz deserve two All-Stars. And I feel like Rudy Gobert has been having a really, really good season. It's flying under the radar because he's doing stuff that he's been doing for the last three seasons. But, like, it looks better because the team's 19-5. Zion is definitely having a better season than B.I. So, Zion is definitely an All-Star. Averaging 23 points, 2 assists, 7 rebounds. B.I. is also averaging 23 points, 4 rebounds, 5 assists. B.I.'s numbers are better, but Zion has been holding them afloat for the last couple games because B.I. has been a little bit inconsistent the past couple weeks. So, Zion's an All-Star. Christian was an All-Star. 20-10. Most improved player of the year already. Their team's 11-11. Their team's doing good. Like I said, 87, a little decent season. 22 points, 3 rebounds. I mean, 3 assists, 8 rebounds. One of the best teams in the league. And you know the Lakers are going to get 2 All-Stars. So between B.I. and Rudy, I'm going to have to put my biasness aside. Even though that might not be a word, I'm going to have to put my bias to the side. And I had to say Rudy deserves to be an All-Star this year. He deserves to be a back-to-back All-Star. You just can't take away from his defense. And 13-14, that's what I like from Rudy Gobert. I'm not going to lie. 13-14. He even had a couple games where he almost hit 30. I forgot who that was. I think that was against the Nuggets. He almost hit 30. So Rudy's been having a great season. And like I said, the team did go on a 10-10 win streak. So I have to give them 2 All-Stars. Not just because of that, but like their team's 19-5. As of right now, they're the best team in the league, record-wise. So, I feel like they deserve 2 All-Stars, and Rudy's been having a really good underrated season. So, that's my team. Like I said, I'm not picking between Donovan Mitchell and De'Aaron Fox because they both have amazing cases. I'm sorry if this episode didn't sound too well. Like I said, I'm actually sick, and this is hard to make, but I said I was going to put it on a Monday, so I'm going to put it out. But other than that, I'll talk to you guys later. Hopefully, I'm feeling good. Pray for me. Pray for my family. Peace out.